Jim, whatever I do it to protect you. So you understand?
I understand.
Get out of here.
Our rebellion is all that remains to push back the Empire.
You think you might be able to help us?
When was the last time you were in contact with your father?
What is this?
It appears he is critical to the development of a super weapon.
If my father built this thing, we need to find him.
All right. How many do I need?
They are requesting a call sign.
It's, Rogue. Rogue One.
The power that we are dealing with here is immeasurable.
If the Empire has this kind of power, what chance do we have?
We have hope. Rebellions are built on hope.
Take hold of this moment. The Force is strong.
Make 10 men feel like 100.
We'll take the next chance. And the next. You're all rebels, aren't you?
Save the rebellion! Save the dream!
Interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
Radio Free Endor, YouTube edition.
Welcome to episode 10 of Radio Free Endor. Now, this is a special episode because we are going to do a roundtable on the new Rogue One trailer. This is, I think, the final trailer. And I am Jamie. With me is Paul.
Hello.
And hopefully we will have Jason W. Chrisman on the line in about 5 minutes. So we'll be giving him a ring so he can give us his views on the trailer. And also we've got a couple of, I think we've got a voicemail of Jonathan Bell, who is abroad studying at the moment. So that should be a good one. So we'll get him on the line as soon as we can. So we shall kick it off and we shall see if Jason is on the line.
Are you there, Jason?
Hello.
It's Jason.
How are you, Jason? Okay.
Hey there.
I'm good.
I'm good. I got a bit of a cold. Well, that probably comes with shaking 180,000 people's hands on New York Comic Con weekend.
My God. How was it? How was the New York Comic Con? Was it good?
It was great. There were so many people. Unbelievable amount of people.
Yeah. Was it busier than Star Wars Europe?
Yeah. I mean,
to be fair, there's a lot more people in New York.
Yeah, you know, the artist alleyway is in a separate building from the rest of the Comic-Con. And and then of course in that building, I'm all the way back in the far right, you know. I kept telling everyone kept asking me, like, you know, where's your booth at or whatever, and I said, well, if the Comic-Con was the bright center of the universe, my table is the farthest from.
that's a quote.
I mean, I was in outer rim territory, no doubt. I mean, there was no, you know, that probably hurt my sales a little bit, but, you know, nine out of 10 people who came by my table bought something.
Oh, excellent.
So, awesome. To sweeten the deal, you had Captain Extravaganza.
I did. And, you know, he got recognized 4 times even out of costume.
Really?
Yeah. So, you know, he He was actually really happy about that.
Was he doing drunk signings?
We did do a drunk signing, and I even did a couple of fake photos and sent them to some friends of, with a $100 price tag on his photo.
I'll tell you, we're going to have to get him on the show, you know. We've just got to get him on, you know, because I think it'd be a right laugh. Well, we really do want to get more into the New York Comic Con with you, Jason, on the next podcast, if that's okay with you. Uh-huh. Yeah, because I bet you've got stories to tell, because I've seen it on TV and I've seen a bit of it on YouTube, but to be actually there, it's got to be it's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, it was amazing, and it was also not amazing at the same time.
Bittersweet.
Jason, Rogue One trailer. What did you think of it?
I loved it. I loved seeing all the new stuff. It was great. Mm. It got me excited again.
It was. I liked the tone of it. I thought the it's like a like a proper war film.
Shows you the war side of it, doesn't it? Yeah.
And it's gritty. It looked really gritty and dirty. Do you know at the beginning?
Yeah.
Gin Erso's father, you know, when he says, you know, when I do to keep you safe. I thought, ooh. And especially how you saw.
Is it Krennic? Is it not Krennic?
Krennic. When he's walking over the plains towards their little hut, I was thinking, right. Oh, man. This is giving me chills, man.
Why did he have to walk over there?
Yeah,
why can't he just land it?
Yeah, do you know, I did think that. I was thinking, he's walked really far. You know what I mean? I bet the sculpture's going, oh, we've got to walk. Let's get speeders, man. Where are
they? At least as well, this does add to the story now as well, obviously, that her father's been doing this under duress, more or less, because he's kind of been, you know, he's got no choice, has he? He's got like a load of, weapons and stuff aimed at him, basically. You come with us, you're going to develop the Death Star. So
Death Troopers.
Yeah, so that adds to that side of the storyline, which is quite good.
And there were some real good aerial shots. Did you notice the aerial shots? Real like I think the last time I seen something like that was in do you remember the reboot of Battlestar Galactica? Have you seen that, Jason? You know, some of the shots where you saw the Vipers flying out and they were like really far away, and then you do like a news shot where you sort of zoom in and you can see them flying.
Yeah, it's like a live action zoom in shot. Yeah.
It reminded me of that, where you saw like a canyon and you saw the U-Wing fly. It looked like the U-Wing, I'm pretty sure it was, flying around the canyon.
With that fallen Jedi.
Yeah, that's right. Yes. It's like I think you've seen part of that landscape in the first trailer, didn't you? Now, basically, you're seeing basically what it's made of. It's a Jedi, isn't it?
Yes. And also, I noticed that Donnie Yen's character, he was smiling. Do you notice how many times he smiled in this one trailer?
Yeah.
He was like, come on, let's do it.
He was up for it.
Did you notice he was firing a gun? He was firing a gun at people.
Yeah, I saw that too.
And I watched it, I was thinking, I wonder if his mate's going, a bit to the left. A bit to the left.
Tapping his shoulder.
It's all right. I can see a lot better.
Just point that direction.
If you hear the scream, you know you hit him. You know what I mean? But I was actually, I walked around the Disney store the other day, and I saw the this new toy of the Donnie Yen figure, and it had him holding his weapon. Now, his weapon is his staff. It's his staff that folds out into a gun. And a lot of people online were saying, oh, I bet you that's like a lightsaber in that. But obviously, no, it's just a blaster at the end of the day.
Gives it away, doesn't it? Yeah, just a bit. Just sometimes it's a shame, isn't it, with the toys. It does give away a lot of hints when the toys come out first.
Hey, yeah, that's
I'm
right.
I'm not supposed to see that.
Yeah, especially with the Lego. And you know about the Lego toys, don't you, Jason? Lego seem to really do spoilers, don't they?
So, yeah, obviously, after she has a flashback, doesn't she, obviously, to her dad and stuff.
And she's in prison as well, isn't she?
This is flashback, and obviously she comes out this flashback and she's in prison, isn't she? So this looks like it's either there must be two different times when she's in prison, because this first one, obviously, she's in like an old hut, whereas when she gets breaking out, you know, when the explosion happens on the door, that's obviously a different type of cell. So she must get either arrested twice or she gets taken somewhere else and is, you know, incarcerated, so to speak. So, and it's that, don't know where that leads.
But did you notice that the guy, the rebel that broke her out?
Cassian Andor, yeah.
He had a right accent on him. Sound like, yeah. You notice, did he sound Scottish? You're like, hey, what are you doing here? Like, it's one out. But you notice the stormtroopers are walking around really, really slowly. They're like, hey, do you hear my footsteps? Clink, clink, chicken out. Clink. But there's also that shot where you're in that the village and it looks up and you can see how close and how big that Star Destroyer is.
Yeah, that was a great shot.
It looked absolutely mental. It reminds me of the Series V. Do you remember the old Series V?
Oh, yeah.
You know, when they used to look up and just see that above the clouds. And I used to think, that's a beautiful matte painting. I would like that. And there's one thing that about this film is scale.
Is even massive,
when you when you see the clouds and you can see the Death Star on, you know, just outside the atmosphere, so it's so big, you know what I mean?
Scarif looks really nice as well, doesn't it, in this clip as well. This looks really vast, and the bit, it's like a jungle that they run through, doesn't it?
Looks really
good. We see a bit of Jeddah, don't we, as well, in the new, well, some of the residents of Jeddah. These, like, we've got like pipes coming out of their covers on the faces and stuff, and staffs and...
Yeah, some new different aliens. And now I was watching that to see if... Do you remember on the old trailer, we said, oh, there's a guy there with no head. Yeah. It looks like it should... And I was trying to, like,
don't
see...
Don't think it's these. I don't think it's this.
It's not the same one.
They're not as stocky as that one that we previously seen without the head.
Also, did you notice, you know, when they were discussing, they had the plans of the Death Star in front of them, you know, when they were all around the display, all in the rebel.
Yeah.
Did you notice?
Go on, Jason. Not the plan so much, but just, the object of the Death Star itself.
Do you know the plans from Star Wars in 77, and now they're showing you this, and I think, I wonder if Disney are going to... do a bit of retcon in here, and do a special edition by just putting these plans into the original Star Wars, just to give it that continuation. You know what I mean? Because somebody down the line is going to say, "Hey, how come they've got the 4K version? We've got the 8-bit. What's happened here?" It's
definitely a hologram. I'm looking at it now. It's a hologram of it, basically.
You see, Mendelsohn's character again, Krennic, and he's actually saying those words to Vader, isn't he, about the power of the Death Star. And we've got that side shot of Vader, but he's not getting it in there. Do you know what I mean? Do you know, when I was watching this, I was in, you know, you do see Vader, don't you? A real good shot of him walking out.
Yeah, through the smoke, like stars in their eyes. Yeah.
And not just, he's walking with some authority too.
Yeah.
It reminded me exactly. Oh, know that guy that I tried to get the autograph of, who said he isn't, but he is. Yeah. He must have studied David Prowse walking, because he walked just like he did in A New Hope. Mm. What do you reckon, Jason? It looked the same sort of walk, because
that was probably part of the casting process, was let's see you walk.
because I remember when I was talking to David Prowse, and he's often said it online, he says it's the walk. You know what I mean? You've got to get the walk right. And he says, if you do watch the films, you can sometimes see when there's a stuntman in the outfit to where David Prowse was, because the walk's slightly different. You know what I mean? And so to get for Spencer to get that walk, I was like, yeah, you've sold me. But you should have signed my bloody Rogue One picture. That would have been a coup and a half if I got
I was going to talk about the X-Wing in space, the part where they're flying around that structure, and one of the X-Wings, I think it's one of the X-Wings, or it could be a TIE fighter. No, it would be an X-Wing that explodes on one of the outlegs. But it's basically that whole space sequence looks excellent. I can imagine that in 3D would be... It would look really vast. It would look really good, really deep. So I'm looking forward to that, definitely, if we get to see it in 3D.
Yeah. I'm hoping it's out in 3D.
I wish I was more excited about 3D, but I'm not. I wish it was. I wish I was more excited about 3D. Yeah. I just don't like wearing those stupid glasses all the time. it's a bit like
Marmite, isn't it, really? It's
I feel like everything's darker too. I don't know.
Because it's based on shutter technology. I follow 3D quite a bit, and it'll be a lot better once they design the glasses that have got the screens, and similar to like what the PlayStation VR is going to be now. But if they brought a pair out like that for like movies and film watching, then it wouldn't be dark. It would be zero crosstalk, and you would have a real good experience.
Oh man, I've just had a real feeling, because I tried the PlayStation virtual, Jason, and I'm sure the guy said to me, he goes, "You can watch TV on this." And what it does is it portrays like a 100-foot screen in front of your eyeballs. I'd be like, Star Wars, straight in. You know what I mean? My wife would be walking in and just see me just sitting there dribbling out of my mouth. He's watching Star Wars. He'd be fine. He'd be fine. Wait till he wants a pee break and then he'd come out of it. Episode 3 now. Oh, man.
Well, you know, that now that they've introduced Jen's father in the trailer... and obviously we're speculating that he is some, you know, one of the architects of the Death Star.
Yeah.
I'm willing to bet that he put that port that we shot that torpedo, that Luke shot that torpedo down into on purpose. He probably designed it with that flaw in it, and they're probably going to incorporate that. Because everyone's saying, blew up the whole Death Star. They could have just put a cover on it, you know?
Yeah. Did anyone put the cover on?
Steel grate or something, you know?
Yeah.
But I'm willing to bet that was... they're going to somehow incorporate that was purposeful.
I think you're right with Arnold, Jason. But how incredibly in his mind that, I'll make this hole, and then I'll just hope... there might be a whoopee Jedi that can just shoot it down the hole. Yeah, my plan will work. Yeah, that's a lot of coincidence, isn't it?
We also seen another shot of something hitting the Earth, don't we, as well?
Oh, it looks like...
Similar to when Erso and Andor escape in the U-Wing. So it could be... I reckon it's going to be a Star Destroyer crash into the planet. That's what I think.
That's a good one, Paul, because we said last time it could be a weapons test. I think you said, Jason, it could be a weapons test on the last...
Could be a weapons test, or it could be a start, It's, you know, it's one of them things, isn't it? We'll have to wait and see.
Yeah.
In that segment, again, I believe you do still see as well that, like, electricity that's coming through the, you know, through the debris. If you watch that little sequence, on the left-hand side, you see, like, some little arcs and sparks. But, like I say, whether it is a weapons test or whether... I would have thought maybe a weapons test would have been a bigger explosion, but I don't know.
Well, I still think it is the weapons test from the Death Star, because we do see a little bit in this trailer of it, like, just starting, like when it just hits the planet. And then, you know, in some other shots and other trailers, it seems like, you know, utter chaos, you know, of things just, the planet just coming apart, really.
Yeah.
I'm just looking at the image now, and it does look like it's a blast straight down, Paul.
Yeah.
And could be wrong. Mm-hmm. It looks like it's coming straight down, and it reminds me of in Star Trek 2 when the Genesis effect takes over a planet, boom, hits it straight, and then you see this spark, you know, this like a puddle in water.
Yeah,
and that slowly coming towards them, so it could be. They do say a major weapons test is imminent.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Right.
Yeah.
But didn't they not say in Star Wars A New Hope it's a good time to test the new weapon as well?
Mm. Well, I think it's full destructive power. So I think they do have, you know, the capability of, you know, shooting, you know, let's do 10% on this planet and see what happens. You know what I mean? And so.
Yeah, you could be right there.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, could be right.
Or it could be someone's just putting their coffee cup down on the red button. What you done, dude? Oh, no one's going to notice. I think they will. And then, of course, straight after that, you've got the shot of Vader walking down a platform towards Krennic, you know what I mean? And, God, that walk. Oh, because everybody wants Vader back. Because the only thing about Disney taking over Star Wars is, well, the major villain is dead. He's dead. And the only way they've brought him back so far is in Rebels, which was fantastic. But now to... He's back. You know what I mean? Because they're doing a prequel. Man, I'd love to see... I'm hoping they'll do this and he will be there and he'd be prominent and everyone would go, right, let's have a Vader film. Let's have an Order 66 film where Vader goes manic and he's hunting down the Jedis to kill. You know what I mean? That's what I want to see. That's what I'd like to see. Proper Vader film. I'm not bothered about Yoda. Do I want to see a Yoda film? No.
We also seen Forest Whitaker's character, didn't we? He's got obviously got two peg legs, hasn't he?
He has, Paul.
Yeah. And obviously he shout, what's he done? Was it Save the Rebellion and Save the Dream or something? Yeah, Save the Dream. Save the Rebellion, Save the Dream. Yeah. Quite emotive how he says it really as well. So
it was
sort
yeah.
of, sort of in a moment of desperation or you know.
He has got two cyber legs, isn't he? That's for sure. Because they released the pop vinyl figure and I think I showed it to you, Paul. I went, look, he's only got one. He's only got one robotic leg. Then I watched this trailer and went, he's got two.
Somebody well, made maybe I think his left leg is more of a brace.
Could be.
On his leg and feet. You know, so it's clanky, but I think his leg is there. Mm-hmm. But his right leg is definitely, you know.
How many million views did you say that video had earlier, Jamie? Was it 4 million?
It had.
It's now at 23.5 million nearly.
You're joking?
No.
As we've been talking.
Yeah.
Are you watching it going up, Paul?
No. I just refreshed it, and it was about 4.5. I think it was about 4 million. And now it's up to 23.5 million.
Well, the one I'm looking at is only at 1.5.
Oh, is it?
Looking at the same point.
This one's on the Star Wars YouTube channel.
Yeah, I'm on the Star Wars YouTube account.
F5, it refresh it and see.
It's got 86,000 likes and just over 1,000. We don't like it.
That's not bad. It's only a 2%.
Let me just send a message to all those Star Trek fans. Hold on a
second. Star Trek.
Yeah, see, this is called continuality.
Continuity, yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Well, now it says 2.187.
Oh, okay.
But this is one source. I mean, it's probably coming from five.
Yeah, it's going to have a lot of views, this is, especially, obviously, this time of day now, especially from the UK, anyway.
There's probably going to be a few international trailers with a couple, you know, three or four spots, maybe, in it.
Yeah, there'll probably be a lot... Obviously, there's going to be the odd trailer come out, you know, as in TV, like a TV advert type thing for it coming out. So you'll probably see a little bit different. But...
The international trailer, Paul, that will have a couple of different more shots. They always do. So that'd be even better. Even did anyone see the Russian one sheet poster they brought out? It was fantastic. I don't know who designed it, but it was like you saw the water and you saw the troopers approaching and you had... just a rebel's helmet sitting in the sand, in the water.
Oh, yeah,
the
I like that.
Love that. Because Jason, I did think of you on it, but, well, somebody's going for a minimalist sort of image there. And it did remind me of Full Metal Jacket.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just looking through the trailer again, and at the beginning when you see Jyn Erso actually in the prison cell.
There's a character with her, isn't there? Yeah, like a...
He's half naked. And he's an alien.
It looks familiar, but I can't think where. It's like District 9 or something. it's like a prawn.
Oh, no, I know. He's actually one of the creatures from the special edition of the canteen scene. The cantina scene. It's at 26 seconds in. I've just froze it. And he sort of... You know when... Jason, you'll probably remember this as well. Do you know when it... In the original Star Wars one, it goes through all the different, see the characters all pop up and look around. Dead sure this is one of them. It's got the tentacles at the bottom.
I see him.
Yeah, I'm dead sure that's one of the new special edition, take new now, but one of the special edition creatures. Yeah. So it's nice to know they've got mixed prisons in the Empire.
And I like the prison doors has the same elliptical lines like you see that are lit up down the hallways of the Empire.
You're right. Yeah. That's a good pickup on that one, Jason. I love that design as well. I've seen, do you know when you're walking down the street and you ever see that kind of sign? I always look at it and think, that's an Empire. You know what I mean? It's talking about the Empire. You know what I mean? It's a really good image. But if you look straight after that scene, and after the Lucasfilm logo comes up, you see the street, and right there on the left is a Death Star droid.
An Imperial droid, yeah.
Yeah.
Is this on Jedha? Yeah.
Jedha, yeah. I've got that figure. That's why I know, because he's one of the first figures I bought.
Like, I got the two light TIE fighters in the background as well. Just there.
Yeah.
He was one of the first droids you see in the Jawa Sandcrawler.
He was as well. Yeah, he was. He's actually down. Isn't he actually classed as Death Star droid? That's sure. The Kenner, it says Death Star droid.
Right.
But that Imperial Star Destroyer, that is amazing shot. That is. Wow, how big it is. And I like how they've got a little satellite dish just underneath it. You can see a satellite dish. Right, it's 34 seconds. And now you said about the TIE fighters, Paul. They're actually going into the bay to dock. Mm. You can just see them coming up to a docking port. But right there on the right is a massive satellite dish. Looks like it should be on the side of the Falcon. That's some detail, yeah. That is. That's some detail.
Yeah. Well, hey, guys, I have to get going.
Right, okay. Well, so, thanks a lot, Jason, for coming on. It's always a pleasure to have you on, mate. Your views you know, we appreciate your views. It's fantastic.
Okay, Jason, yeah, thanks for coming on, chap.
And, you know, you're welcome back on Radio Free Endor anytime.
Well, thanks for having me, guys. I love talking to you guys. Great, it's so stuff. Much fun.
And next time you're on, we'll definitely have to talk about New York Comic Con.
Definitely. And, you know, maybe I'll bring Captain Extravaganza with me.
Oh, that'd be ace. That'd be ace.
He was with me the whole time, so he's got plenty of stories.
Right. I'll see you later then, Jason. You take care.
Cheers.
All right, thanks, guys.
So it was great to have Jason. I mean, pity he couldn't stay any longer, but he's a busy man with his ass. You know, and he's got a lot of meetings, so he's had to get off. But he will be back. He will be back.
He's a regular Radio Free Endor.
He's one of those people that you can guarantee if we had a bar, he'd be there propping it.
Yeah.
He's a good lad. We like him.
He is a sound.
Now, before we go any further, Paul, Jonathan Bell, who couldn't join us today, he's actually sent me some voicemail about his views of the new trailer. So what we'll do is we'll have a listen to what he says.
Hello, Radio Free Endor. This is Jonathan coming from Sungyang in the Seoul capital area, Korea. Just thought that I would give you my thoughts about the trailer since I wasn't able to join you guys because the time difference, it just didn't work out. I'm going to give you some of my thoughts I wrote down about the trailer. So I really love the shot at the beginning, just seeing the blue sky with the Death Star in the back, and I assume that looks like it's the sky looks like it's from like that Japanese poster that was released a few weeks ago, and then seeing that bird fly over. At first I thought, wait a second, was that like a, you know, a small ship? Then when I've watched the trailer so many times that it just kind of flew so straight that I thought it was a ship, but I think it's actually a bird. So yeah, I really love that. We got a little bit more into the talk of Jin's father and her story, and, you know, we get the little flashback. Her father, you know, kind of telling her how to, you know, that kind of father moment of, you know, listen to me, and, you know, for the future, well, all that kind of stuff. I assume the conversation will be like that. Another thing, the TIE fighters roaring by definitely took me back to the OT. I mean, you know, we have like TIE fighters and, you know, like Rebels, and that's cool. But just hearing that, like, original sound, I assume Matthew Wood involved and just did a great job with this. Maybe Ben Burtt. So also, another thing I wrote down is that saw that a statue of a Jedi, perhaps, lying covered by sand, perhaps taken down during the Purge. I thought of Obi-Wan with the hood over him, perhaps just kind of an inspiration of the past and to maybe look to the future of perhaps a Jedi will come back, and hint. You know, so Jin's kind of frustrated, what's going on? I feel like I don't have the whole story. You know, so it's one of those kind of feelings where you feel like, I wish you guys would tell me more stuff, but I'm not sure. You know, we're just kind of seeing clips here and here. We're not getting the whole story. So, you know, Father is involved in the Death Star, we know, and he, we already know that, they sent the plan, they sent, like, the, you know, the weapons test kind of news, you know, and that the, it's almost complete and such, the actual, Death Star, and, you know, and just kind of trying to, figure out what they're gonna do, and she's like, you know, we should probably find him, you know, and get the plans, you know, we're just not really quite sure, you know, how exactly will he factor into the story. Will he have, like, a, you know, a father-daughter reunion or something? Call sign, you know, Star Wars is all about the call signs, and this is, like, Rogue One, you know, and definitely cool. A lot of times you see in the trailers, you just kind of get this little, kind of coming up with a call sign or the title in the trailer, so... I mean, being the Rebellion is already dangerous, and just, this is on a different level, obviously. You know, it's a suicide mission. I mean, I am kind of wondering, you know, any parallels, you know, we'll have to, like, you know, Rebels, the crew of the Ghost. By the way, who's digging Rebels on that latest episode, the Antilles? Really good episode. Really, all three episodes are good so far. Thank you, iTunes, for the episodes. So, Krennic, you know, great lines, you know, about how, you know, this is such powerful laser and such. He's a bit obsessed, we already knew that, about finishing the Death Star, and I mean, he's just venting in front of Vader, you know, we just see the back of him, and he's just kind of like, do you understand the power of this? And Vader's kind of like, we just, you know, just kind of standing there. I mean, obviously, it's not like he's, like, taking it as a subordinate, he's just kind of like, okay, you can keep talking. And then he's gonna talk, I don't know, you know, so I guess, yeah, so he's a bit obsessed, but he's staking his reputation on this, you know? The Emperor wants it done, so if you get that thing done, you know, promotion. Well, another line that sticks out to me, when Jen, you know, does the smile, and she's with a bunch of other people, and she's like, you know, rebellions are built on hope. You know, I thought that's a big thing. I mean, a new hope, you know? I mean, I don't think... I kind of have my doubts. I mean, I'm pretty sure only, like, Yoda and Obi-Wan know about, you know, like, another person that's gonna come. Hint, hint, Luke. You know, I don't think that's the kind of hope this rebellion is specifically talking about, but it's still, you know, a kind of hope to save the galaxy, perhaps. You know, it's a new hope. I think it's Donnie Yen's character. Sorry. Anyway, I don't want to look it up now. Anyway, it says to hold on to this moment, the Force is strong. You know, so even though there are not any, you know, Jedi in the movie, I like that the Force is, you know, being discussed, and that someone in the film embraces it, you know, with his staff and such. Oh, cheer it, down on my notes. Okay, wants the Rebellion to embrace the Force. They say, you know, in a lot of the, you know, in the movies, like in A New Hope, you know, as I said, say, may the Force be with you and such, even though, kind of like, you know, God bless, even if we don't like, even if religion, or in this case, the Force is discussed, you know. So it's, sure, it says to embrace the Force, you know, and that's what Luke does, to destroy that Death Star, fire that thing. So as we see in Rebels and The New Hope, the Force and the Jedi aren't talked about, like I mentioned earlier. They will be talked about, of course. So maybe another thing is, you know, everyone doing their part. We don't know who's coming out of this alive, of course. Another thing I wrote down is Diego Luna's character, you know, make 10 men feel like 100, you know, that definitely feels like some kind of war line, you know, and this is a war film. In general, I just love all the cinematography and all the special effects. The AT-ST, the CG is kind of, or props, I don't know, it looks so-so. It definitely looked digital. I mean, I just love the kind of the beaches and the jungles. I know some of it's green screen, but a lot of it just looks really, really great. You know, in Saw Gerrera, I mean, that really chilling scene, you know, save the Rebellion, save the Dream. I mean, he's a veteran, he's been, you know, since the Clone Wars, and he goes back to the Clone Wars. He's seen where the galaxy has gone. Many years just have gone by, and he's just kind of seen where it's just gone from one hell to another, and it's just, I don't think he's making it out, to be honest. I don't think a lot of them are making it out, but he's going all in, you know. He's kind of the, what will you become? Just, you know, that line with, I mean, Forrest Whitaker, he's great. I mean, yeah, I think that's about it, though. And I look forward to hearing your conversation. And I guess I'll talk to you later. Good night from Korea.
Well done with that one.
Now we'll jump back into it. So I'm just bringing up the trailer again.
When that trailer first opens as well, it's got like a... It looks like it's a ringed planet that we're looking at, because it's, yes, got like a Saturn ring around it, like a Saturn ring.
Yeah.
With the Imperial shuttle coming down for a landing, yeah.
That is, and the shot is, it looks photorealistic with that, you know what I mean?
I think it's just a straight sky shot, and they've just obviously added CGI into it.
Yeah.
But it does look really good.
It looks really good. And as it goes along, you know, you've got the water coming up. And then the next shot is of, I can't think of his name, Jyn Erso's father, looking at the shuttle.
His name is Gallen. Gallen.
Gallen, that's right.
Gallen Erso.
Now, looking at that pole, at the shot where he's standing there, watching them walk towards him.
Yeah.
It looks like he's got hydroponics, babe. He's got a hydroponics in a line across at 8 seconds into it. Hydroponics.
Okay.
If you watch, and he's actually got those water refineries sitting there, so he's really smart, because this place looks quite barren where they are. And thinking about it, what we said with Jason about why he hasn't parked closer, if you look on the opposite side, you know, towards it's got rocks everywhere, so I bet you they've had to land there for the simple reason it's safer to land there. But do you think he'd come out saying, stay in formation, boys, me in the middle. three that side, let's go.
It'd look a bit awkward if there was four of you on the left and two on the right.
Yeah, looking at the other shot, the opposite way, where you actually seen them walking towards Jyn Erso's house. Yeah, they're definitely...
Death troopers.
No, not death troopers. Machines. Evaporators. Is that what it is? Evaporators. Should know more than this. Should know that. Listen, I'm a big Star Wars fan. I don't kind of what that machine is.
It's all new, don't worry. It's all new.
Let's start again. It's all new. We don't know anything. But he's got such a little hut. Looks like.
It's like a
Mars.
It's like a little mini Eden project.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's quite nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, and they walk through his field. They don't walk around it, they walk through it.
Do you mind?
Do you know how long it's took me to grow that? And he looks proper... he looks proper wet. And then when you go back onto the other... to Krennic, don't he look miserable? Looks miserable, and it must
be very...
soaked. He's soaked as well. I've come for you for a mission. Yes.
I think the little girl that they've actually chose to play Jyn Erso is the Spitz. She is a Spitz of her.
Yeah.
They've really done well there in casting that young girl.
Yeah, they have. You're right there. Very, very pretty. Very, very much like her.
He looks, as well, you know, like her father as well, when they approach him, and obviously where he's really wet. He looks like a young Arnold Schwarzenegger, doesn't he? He's got like a... There's something about him, facial features, but he's look very familiar.
Yeah. I know what you mean. He was at, do you know, Paul, he was actually in the remake of Clash of the Titans.
Okay.
And I loved his character in that.
Yeah.
I thought he was fantastic. He played this proper, like, soldier, you know what I mean? He's been through the wars. He was such a good character in that. And I, for some reason, I never, ever connected him, that actor, from that to this, to Quantum of Solace, Hannibal. Never, my brain just, no, wasn't him. It's only like, I've seen him in the beard here, and I've gone, hold on, I've seen him in Clash of the Titans. So, I tell you what, though, the shots are, whoever's done this trailer has really outdone themselves.
I'm not worried now about the reshoots that needed to be done now for this.
No.
It's like I say, this trailer's really like made you see the other side of the film. Not as cryptic as what the first trailer was. There's obviously a lot more questions being answered, obviously, if you sit and investigate it. But a lot of the direction it's going.
Yeah, same here. You know, we talked about scale. There's a lot of shots in this film that show you the scale of it. And I know we touched upon it, but... before when Jason was here, but do you know that rock formation you see the U-ring flying across? I never realized that was a fallen Jedi until you said, Paul, and I was like, what? I'm going to have to just have a quick look. It's dead right.
Yeah, it's massive. Obviously, when you see the ship going across the top, it just gives you an idea of the scale of it again as well, doesn't it? It is really good.
That is an amazing shot, that is.
Like I said, I'm pretty sure that you've seen that in the previous trailer. Obviously, from ground level, so you couldn't really make it out, but this basically answers that. So probably this is a follow-on section from that trailer.
Now, the music to this trailer... when I first watched the trailer, Paul, I was thinking, is this Michael Giacchino's score? Because he's been, he replaced Alexander Desplat. And if you remember the music from that trailer, it was more darker, wasn't it? It was very, very... And it did sound like it was made for the trailer.
Yeah.
Where this one, I thought, this sounds... You know, there is the Star Wars theme at the beginning and a bit at the end. Mm. But I've later found out, Paul, that it's just standard trailer music. It's actually online. Yeah.
Trying to save some cash.
The actual track that's playing, listeners, is actually by Ninja Tracks, the Machine Nation. MachinaTion. Now, if you just put Ninja Tracks, Epic Trailer Ninja Tracks, it will actually bring up that bit of music for the trailer. Mm. The only thing that's missing from it is the little bit of the Force signature right at the beginning and right at the end. Yeah. The rest of the music is there, and which is probably playing in the background right now. That's what we're talking.
Mm.
But as soon as I found it, I thought, oh my god, because I love trailer music. Because that must be really hard to do, Paul, because you do music yourself.
Yeah, try to.
You've got to, you know, somebody comes up to you and says, right, we've got 2.5 minutes, I want this epic trailer music, and you've got to come up with something that's telling the story itself, because that's what basically it's doing, isn't it? It's telling the story of that trailer from beat to beat to beat to beat. It must be really hard. But this music, I've never heard it before, because on it, some trailers you go, oh, I've heard that music on another trailer, but this one's brand spanker. In fact, that music that was played was published, I think, today. It came online today. So as soon as the trailer itself came online, that came online. Which was October the 13th, folks, if you're listening to this in the future.
That's obviously some kind of joint venture between the artist and the actual clip.
It could be. Sometimes they just pay them. They just give them a water cat. Can we use your music?
Yeah.
But being a Star Wars trailer, I would have thought they probably would have made custom music for the trailer itself. I could be wrong. It could be actually custom music, but and they've given permission to put it out there once the trailer's out. Because since Star Wars Episode 7, there's been a lot of call for the trailer music, because the special, I think it was the Comic-Con trailer that came out, that was sort of like a making of, if you remember, Paul.
Yeah.
That music came out. You could buy that music off iTunes, which I did. And the other previous the music from the previous two trailers, you can get them. They've been separated from the actual track. And some people have actually done them themselves, you know, reproduced it. And they've done a cracking job of reproducing it.
Yeah.
Absolutely cracking job. And you know how hard it is, when you're trying to reproduce something.
I was doing it on the last podcast, wasn't I, with the intro?
Yes.
The Endor things type.
Yeah, you was, intro. Yeah. And for the viewers, when this is on YouTube, on our last podcast, when I converted it to for the YouTube channel, I submitted it. YouTube came back at me and said, you can't use this for copyrighted reasons. And so there's bits where there's silence, and that was on the main intro, and a bit where we were discussing about Alexander Desplat's music being replaced, and the end as well. So there's big chunks of nothing where they've stripped it. Thanks, YouTube. You know what I mean? And the only thing that flashes through my mind, Paul, is all the other. How do people put music? How do people put albums on and not get copyrighted by them? And they're just every Tom, Dick and Harry. But oh well. So for the future podcast listeners, me and Paul are going to try and just sort out some unique music by our resident music man Paul for the intro and the outro. Just some little bits just for the YouTube channel. Now on the normal podcast, which you can download from iTunes, still you will get the original John Williams greatness theme. I'm not saying the Paul's theme, so they are folks. If you believe in Paul, send him some messages of "We believe in you, Paul. We believe in you," because he's done some cracker tracks. You only have to listen back, go back in time to our very first episode that me and Paul did, which was under new management, season two, episode one. You can hear a fantastic track by Paul himself, which was just. I've got it on my iPhone. It's amazing. Absolutely. Right.
Anyway.
Now, getting back to this trailer. Do you know the droid? The droid's fantastic in this.
Yeah, the one that got a bit of a comical streak in him. Yeah.
Yeah, you know.
He can actually fly, can't he?
Yeah, he can. He can actually fly. He's not afraid to shoot people as well.
No.
You notice like, there he is firing the blasters.
Yeah.
And awesome. Saying that in the last trailer, he did say, you know, you're supposed to be a friend. I won't kill you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I bet he was like a death droid in his previous incarnation.
Bit like an assassin.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Could be an assassin droid, yeah. Mm. Right there. Again, you also see them testing the viewer screen in it as well. It's 1 minute, 22 seconds. You see them testing out the view screen, which is, he's like, is that HD quality, mate? It should be. It's 4K. See how big it is?
8 inch.
Yeah. And again, what Jason was saying is when the rebels were all gathered, And they're showing the Death Star.
Yeah.
That's a fantastic hologram projection. Absolutely fantastic.
Mm.
Right, and now I'm just looking at that image of all the people in that, you know, around that table. And to the far left, Paul, at 1 minute 24 seconds, looks like a very pale Admiral Ackbar. Ryan, that's you know, but he's very pale. I wonder if it is Admiral Ackbar, but in his younger days.
1 minute 24. Yeah.
1 minute 24 seconds. He's right there. They're looking at the hologram of the Death Star in the middle.
Yeah.
He's over there, and they've done a fantastic job in some of these characters that are around this table. Of course, played are replaying roles that were in the original 1977 version.
Yeah.
And they look spot on. Of the characters, absolute spot on of the original ones.
Well done to the wardrobe department there. Definitely.
Now, wondering who this lady is who's in the gold.
Yeah, like a tabard, not tabard as such. Yeah, like a robe, isn't it? Like
a robe. Yeah. I'm not too sure who she is, but the guy to the far left of the image with Jyn Erso, he was in. Sherlock Holmes.
It could be part of a council or something. It's like maybe they're deciding what to do.
Yeah, true.
Do you know, just in this very next scene, just as we see
the
AT-ST walk coming down the stairs.
Yeah.
Just as the camera changes, you've got a character walking off the left hand side with a big pack on its back.
Yeah,
it's like it's like a big Ewok.
Yeah, you're right. Look at that. He's massive.
I can't say I've seen that character before. But yeah, he's got like a massive, like, kind of Ghostbusters type pack on his back.
I've seen him. He's actually a character that you can buy. He's in a two pack. Dead sure. Do you know, Paul? Don't know names. Can't come up with names at the moment. It. But I've seen that character.
Mm.
He's in. He is actually as an action figure you can actually buy. He is.
Yeah, so must have a little bit of a role in the film, so to speak. I would imagine if it's a purchasable character.
And like you were saying, he's doing a quick walkout. See you later.
Time's time.
And that walker, have you noticed the attack walks just like how it is in the Return of the Jedi?
It actually looks to me more menacing. It's actually a bit War of the Worlds type, you know, kind of effect. But I love the camera work out. It's like a kind of looking straight up this alleyway. You know, it's a real good shot.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, it really is. And as you're looking at the stormtroopers, they're all coming down. They're just like, the stormtrooper's dead. It's just carnage everywhere.
That's it.
Absolute carnage. I love that shot. He just blasts that guy right in the chest, that AT-ST does.
Yeah.
Just checking it out. Just, you can actually see the explosion on him.
You can.
It's like, that is mental. I'm just showing Paul the explosion on. Boom!
Yeah, eat that.
Yeah, he's got it in the face.
So obviously, then you're looking at, obviously the next shot is when you're looking at Forrest Whitaker's feet. Now, the one, as we're looking at it, the left foot is completely, obviously, been replaced, whereas the right one, I'm not sure, because it looks like it's a shoe, but it looks very thin where his ankle is.
Yeah, it is. To me, it looks like a prosthetic.
Yeah, it does. It does to me. Could be wrong. Jason could be right. But yeah, it's definitely one of them. It's definitely gone, but I'm not sure what that the other one is on the other foot.
Yeah, the shoe's on the other foot, dude.
Yeah, that's right. He's also got like a breathing mask, isn't he, on his chest there? It looks like a breathing mask.
Similar to what Vader's got.
Yeah,
he's got a tube and everything, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you know, it reminds me of one of my favourite characters, Boshak. His uniform had the same kind of tubes on it.
Yeah.
Paul, just before we go onto that bit, do you know when we were just before with the AT-ST talk?
Yep.
Right, now, if I play that, this might sound really, really weird when it comes to a Star Wars film, but do you know when you see these war films and somebody gets shot and killed, they go down like a sack of spuds, boom, you know what I mean, dead lifeless. Now, I'm just playing this bit over and over again where that guy gets shot in the face.
Yeah, and he's like, he falls, flops, he just completely flops, didn't he?
Proper dead weight.
To his right, yeah.
Proper dead weight, and he just, the way, you know, he just hits the floor.
Yeah.
It's giving me chills just thinking about that, because that has proper destruction. That's proper death. You know what I mean? And we've not, you know, people, you know, you see the stormtroopers get shot an awful lot of times in Star Wars films, but seeing something like that is very different.
Especially for Disney as well, because Disney obviously don't really do death, do they? You know.
No, they don't. They don't.
So whoever's actually took that on and decided to go that way with it, and fair play to them. Like I say, this is the more grittier side, definitely.
Oh yeah, I really do hope they keep the, you know, the grittiness of it, and I'm hoping I want to see a dark film, a dark Star story. I really do. Even though, you know, when you go to a minute and 39 seconds into it, where you see that big structure near the palm trees, you know, it looks very beautiful and exotic.
Yeah, it does.
But it has got that you know that these people are going to die on this beach, especially when you see that massive, it's like a trench all the way to that building.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, there's a landing pad right in front of it. Now, I wonder if that structure is something to do with like a tethering to the Death Star. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Why it's in orbit, they do like there's a tethering for the weapon or something.
Yeah, because that's where the Death Star was reportedly built, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Scarra.
But if you look around that scenery, it's a properly industrial area. It's not just one structure. There's buildings and buildings and buildings all the way into the distance. But you can also see the shoreline behind them. But that's a proper complex, that is.
Yeah.
And it gives you the impression that it's like a wheel. You know what I mean?
What's that craft coming in on the left-hand side there? That's there's a craft there.
Yeah, you're right.
That's not the one that we see in the very first part where you see the ring around the planet, is it? No.
That's, looking at that, Paul, I can see two wings on one side, two wings on the other. That is that ship that gets blown up. It's one of the, you know, in fact, the droid is firing from it. You know what I mean? It's got two wings up. And I think in the last trailer, you saw the Star Destroyer. When you saw the Star Destroyer above the city, you actually saw one of them flying up towards it. It's like a trooper carrier. It's like a troop carrier.
Yeah.
That's where it is. Two wings on one side, two on the other.
Yeah.
Definitely, that is definitely that. And you know, this scene where you see all the troopers running across the palm trees.
Yeah.
Fantastic. The scenery.
That's a brilliant filming location, that is. Where they filmed that section, but I like how the camera's moving to the right, but obviously panning to the left, yeah.
As they're running across, yeah, it's giving that fantastic shot.
Perspective, yeah.
And the way they're dressed, it's just fantastic. I'm looking at it, I've just froze it now. It's absolutely fantastic.
Now, on the next, just on that next section where you've got Jyn Erso and you've only got the droid and who's on the left now? What's his name on the left? The one that come and rescued? Is he the one that come and rescued her from the prison?
Yes, that's that the moon, isn't it? The one who pilots the wiring. Look at him.
Well, see how she's
dressed.
Got dressed and got this mask on.
She's dressed. If you remember on the last trailer where she's the black suit and the lights go around her.
That's right. But she's not got the helmet on now. I wonder if that's got some kind of visor which just comes down to cover her. Because I think she mentioned something about along the lines of they won't see us coming or something.
Yeah, you're right. So they're doing a bit of infiltration here.
Yeah.
Because he's dressed like an officer.
Yeah.
And she's
low rank.
And she's got that armor on, that black, where you could see what looks like a katana behind her back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big nunchuck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, in the very next scene, you see all three of them standing there. The very next scene at 1:43, all three of them are sitting there, standing there, and she's got that visor.
Yeah,
it's got like it's nothing there. You can just see her eyeballs. Which, yeah. Again, she looks like she's got the two knives. You know, the Deadpool knives in the back.
Yeah, that's it.
But he looks fantastic. I love the look of that droid. He's just.
He does, yeah.
I've seen him in the Disney shop. I think I think
that'll be that character would be a big seller. I think that droid.
I like how big he is. It's just nice.
So now you see a bit more of Donnie Yen's character again, don't we? After this scene, as he's watching them come flying by, and then
that's a great shot. That is such a good shot where they're flying by him in the rain as well. So all the light is shining off all the raindrops. And like we said when Jason was on, he's smiling a lot. Is like, let's go for it. He's, you know,
it makes you wonder if, like, I think he says one line and it's something about the Force is strong or something in this trailer. And it makes you wonder if he is Force, obviously Force sensitive, and if that's what's giving him, you know, the passion and.
I think we've been misled down the line.
I think he knows something that we don't. That's why he's smiling.
Yeah, I think he is a Jedi down the line. I think he is a Jedi, but he's because of Order 66, he's kept himself to himself. And of course, he's been blinded, so he's using all that Force sensor. Because you see him with a blaster pull. You know what I mean, he's firing at people, and blind men don't fire blasters unless they're. Like we said with Jason, it points on the left a little bit. But going on to the next scene, which is 1:46, you see the scene with the aliens I bet you they're like freedom fighters, because these look like they were being shot at in that other scene with the AT-ST.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he looks fantastic. He looks very much like... a character from the Knights of the Old Republic, that alien. He's got the breathing mask and the two pipes coming down.
Very steampunky.
Yeah.
Now I wonder, because obviously the fellow to the right behind him is obviously just a human who's obviously got a gun.
Yeah.
So now do they end up becoming allies for us, or you know, because obviously they're pointing the guns but they're not firing. So
yes,
is there some kind of standoff there where an agreement's made between you to both fight against, you know, the Empire.
Yeah, it could be. And like the next scene straight after that, Paul, is where you got Donnie Young fighting, and he's already knocked down 5 stormtroopers. And just as he finishes his finishing move, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 troopers get blasted in one go.
Yeah.
Who shoots them? And he's like, he's probably just going, did I get them all? Yeah, you did great, mate. Yeah, you did them all in one go. Well done. Yeah. Happy meals all the way around.
The next scene looks really good as well. When are these the X-Wings, aren't they?
Yes.
Basically bombarding the surface of the planet they're on.
Just looking at it. Really you can good. See a Y-Wing. You can see two Y-Wings, an X-Wing. Yeah,
there's some X-Wings that are crashing down as well. Just behind, there's a chap that comes out from, who runs around the side of a rock, and you just see him in the background with the X-Wings coming straight down, nosediving. And crashing out.
That is amazing. I've got a right good shot here, paused it right good, where you can actually see the wing of the X-Wing. I'm just showing Paul
that's
again.
It. Yeah, that's it.
That's a cracking shot, isn't it?
Yeah,
it's 1 minute 51 seconds in, and you can actually see you can see it. In fact, Paul, right above that, you can see the pilot that's ejected.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah.
See him?
Yeah.
Proper, like, you can actually see his legs. He's like, eject! Oh, good for him. Let's hope he survived.
Then we're back to Don Yen again, kicking some boot. Kicking some butt.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he's got his weapon out there, isn't he? Let me just see if he see it actually pop out.
Yeah, I think you do see it fold out.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, you do. You see it just extend at the end. That's wicked, that is. That looks brilliant. Yeah.
Proper like
a transformable weapon, yeah.
Looks like a proper like a crossbow, but really large. I've just clicked it, Paul. Just as it's got, as he pulls it over, it goes out.
Yeah.
And if you notice, he's actually looking down the eye hole. There's like a spike bit on the top that's popped that came up.
Just after that, there's this other chap here now that's hiding behind these boxes. Now, he's sitting there contemplating. Now, I don't know whether he's wholeheartedly wants to fight, because it looks like he's like, obviously, he doesn't want to be there. Mm. If you know what I mean? At 150, I think it's 154.
That's right. He was the one that said our call sign is Rogue One.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
And now, in a previous trailer, you actually seen some X-Wing pilots being in handcuffs with blood on the face. He was one of them. He was one of them. So it wouldn't surprise me, Paul, if this film also examines shell shock.
Yeah could very well do,
you know. It's shell shock, and he generally looks terrified, because at the end of the day, you know, these people are out to kill, you know, as simple as that. They are very much like the Nazi regime in the World Wars. And you know, you were going to die. You know, I mean, that's the thing. And like we've been saying on analysis of this trailer, Paul, people are dying in this, and I mean, dead. Yeah. I mean, not comic book dead,
no,
but dead.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But Saving Private Ryan dead.
Yeah,
there's a big difference there.
Yeah, definitely.
I'd be interested in actually seeing what rating this gets. You know, when it gets its rating.
I think it might. It's going to be a 15. I would have thought. I thought it'd be 15.
No, just getting back, Paul, to Bodhi Rook.
Yeah.
Remembered his name, Bodhi Rook, who's hiding there. If you look at the next shot that's straight after that, it's actually legging it with wires into the
launch craft there, whatever.
Yeah.
It's a T. Yes, he is.
And
so he's obviously just waiting for his time to go, yeah.
Yeah. And if you notice on that shot at 1 minute 56 seconds, you've got the rebels on the right, but if you look on the left, you've got stormtroopers as well as those desert, ground troopers. You know, in the brown, in the, you know, the cream colored.
There's three different factions of them, isn't
there?
He's
legging it in. And then, what is this next image with these more X-wings being smashed up?
Yeah, it's excellent.
156. Do you know, Paul? I've just paused it on 156.
Yeah.
When they look X-wing like proper models. I mean, proper good models. You know what I mean? That shot.
It will look really good in 3D, this section will.
Oh, my God, yeah.
I mean, if it was like...
That is shot off. Look at that. Look at the detail on that.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, we are showing each other images, folks. Yeah, but if you go to 1 minute, 57 seconds, you see this giant, what looks like a circular hub that's in space, and the X-Wings are flying through the spokes of it. It looks like spokes, doesn't it, Paul?
Yeah.
And
I don't know what craft that would be, though, the flying round. Is it some kind of command control center? Because it's obviously in orbit, because it's not part of the, obviously, the Death Star or anything like that, because it's...
I know, I do see one of the old Death Star trench gunners being blown up on the left on it, 1 minute 57. You can just see one being blown up in the middle of the spokes sort of thing, being blown up. That looks proper like one of those turrets. So these pilots have obviously been practicing on the old Star Wars arcade machine, because he knows exactly what to blast and what to miss. and then, of course, then you've got another shot of them. In fact, it's 1 minute 58. These shots are purely a seconds, isn't they?
Yeah.
You can actually see there's two X-Wings flying towards you. If you look in space above, you can actually see the medical frigate, which in Empire Strikes Back, it was featured more in Empire Strikes Back, but you can see that there. So the actual Rebels, and these must be other ships, they're actually, they're transporters, troop transporters as well. I can see them, which... Wow. I've got that toy. Yes. they're in orbit around this thing. So,
yes.
Oh, just seeing it playing out, that bit of footage a bit more. And you can actually still, if you look up, there's a couple of medical frigates and definitely some Rebel transporters in the air. So it looks like they're trying to escape. So I bet you this has actually come to them. You know what I mean? And they're like, oh.
Yeah. And the next scene, obviously, after that now is the K2SO. Is it a K2SO? I think it's K2SO, isn't it?
It is K2SO, yes,
At the helm of the bridge.
He's right, giving flying. It yeah. Yeah, it's probably, yeah, and he's shooting straight after that, that ship. It. That's that ship we were talking about, you said you saw in the air.
Yeah.
The four-wing thing.
Yeah, so it looks like he's landing that, whether to pick somebody up.
And then, of course, the next shot is that a little bit more of a speech, but then at 2 minutes three, you actually see the explosion that's happening. And like you say, Paul, there's like lightning everywhere. It's absolutely fantastic. That is, and you can see the ground just rumbling like anything. In fact, Paul, I will even go to say, if you look, I'm going to go out on a limb on this.
Yep.
Right on that shot where the explosion is, if you look just over to the right slightly, you can actually see what looks like a bit of a tower.
Yeah.
Which I think that looks like the tower of that. You know that big, that sitter where the Star Destroyer was sitting above.
Yeah.
I bet you that's that.
Yeah.
I bet you that's that.
So that could very well be that primary weapon then being tested. Yeah.
Yeah. And this looks like they're in some other kind of like a monastery structure. That's been abandoned for years, but they're watching that destruction, and that is
it'll be like a Jedi training place, wouldn't it? Yeah.
That destruction is that big, it's in slow motion. You know, something like that. You've seen many big fires
that
just look like they're just in slow motion, even though there's some just serious power going on.
Just because of the serious size of it, yeah.
And of course, it goes straight on to the Vader walking out,
and some more shots again of the forest with Donnie Yen and with an AT-AT nearly getting crushed.
just between them two, Paul, you see Mance Mikkelsen's character, yeah. Genoso's father. He's on his knees in the rain, right? Mm. But the outfit that he's in and where he is. Looks like that Kefalron scene to the one that was earlier on in the trailer where you see him walking up that platform.
Yeah.
So I wonder if he's getting ready to be executed or something. And of course, you've got that speech, haven't you, by Forrest Whitaker straight after that.
Yeah.
Now, the AT-ATs, you see the AT-ATs attacking.
Yeah.
You notice one of them's got its doors open. You can see straight through.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
It's like Thunderbird 5.
Yeah. Now, folks, if you know us, where we live in this old AT-AT, that's what was in it when we found it, and we put all the floors in it. But also, Paul, if you look, one's walking the opposite way to them. One's walking towards them, and one, you know, so they're sort of. And if you look,
where's that laser bolt going?
Yeah, well, they're hitting the floors, right? So they're in the middle, and they've been flanked. So one's, I bet you, that if I just play that scene, there's one on the floor, an AT-AT that's actually on the floor, and one on fire.
Got you.
It's really, really quick. It's really, really quick. And so they're being flanked, and of course, these other two AT-ATs well, I think they're called AT...
AT-AST, I think they
are. Yeah, let's call them AT-ATs, man. They're AT-ATs, right? They're actually flanking them. And, of course, then these Jyn Erso and that are coming over as reinforcements, I think, for that. Fantastic. And of course, then you've got them running through the front, right next to
big
right next to the foot, the attack foot, just coming down,
almost gets squashed.
Yeah, and you notice he doesn't even tell the blind man, run to the left.
Save your own skin. And that's basically the end of the old trailer there. So
absolutely fantastic,
great trailer, absolutely great trailer. Yeah,
yeah, and that's the last one. That's the last one. Apart from the, Jason was saying about the international trailer, we might get a little bit more footage, and then we might get some, what do they call them? TV spots. You'll have these, like, 20, like a 5-10 second TV spot, boom, 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 just towards the preview. So, yeah, cracking. Absolutely loved it.
Yeah,
loved
great stuff. Loved
it. Absolutely fantastic. Trailer, and I bet you even now some fans are putting a super cut together.
Yeah,
right. They're either going to string them all together, or they're trying to put them really going over them and putting them in sequence. Somebody did that with the last two trailers. I wonder if he's going to do it with this one. But absolutely fantastic. Loved it. Great stuff. Talking about, because this was what me and Paul often do. We swap trailers over. Did you see that other trailer I sent you that somebody done of? Like a weird mic take of trailer 2.
No, I didn't see it. I don't think I did, no.
Right, it's called Star Wars Rogue One Weird Trailer by Aldo Jones, right? It's bizarre as anything. I mean, it's proper bizarre. It's used pop culture references and put them in the Rogue One trailer. And it's weird, Paul. It's just I'll put a link in the show notes to it because it's proper weird. And he's done a couple of other trailers for Justice League. The Justice League one is really funny, and a Batman versus Superman film. But this one is just unbelievable. It's like Jyn Erso's got 2, 4, 6, 7 eyeballs. And do you know when the camera pans up and you see the big Star Destroyer? It's the ship from Futurama.
Yeah.
Right. Oh man, it's proper weird. Let me just show you. There it is.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Right. Yeah. It is proper weird trailer. But the guy who's done it, he's got to be a smart cookie. I mean, proper smart cookie. The way he's putting no end of stuff, and it's like, do you know when the robot says to Jyn Erso, goes, "I've been told you're a friend. I will not kill you." Well, in this one, he goes, "I will kill you," and he pulls out a blast and blows her head straight off. And
that's a different film.
And that other guy goes, "Oh my god!" It's so funny. Oh my god! When they go out and they see the U-wing take off, it's actually the DeLorean taking off. It is absolutely bonkers.
What was he taking? He was on something when he done that.
Yeah. Deadpool's in it. Who else is in it? Some Gundam styles in it.
Oh no!
A lot of like Deadpool. Oh, Bruce Wayne's in it. Just whipping along here. Superman's in it. Baywatch. What else is it? Oh, Shrek. Shrek's in it as well. Oh my god! Oh, Ace Ventura's in it. Yeah.
Proper like Ace Ventura.
Yeah. I'll definitely put the show notes to both trailers because they are worth it. I'll also put on the show notes the music for this trailer for the normal Rogue One by Epic trailer. So we'll put all that down. So that's it. That's the end of episode 10. Yeah. It's been a great one. It's always good to get our friends back and talk about trailers.
Absolutely. Yes.
Great. So what we're going to be doing then, listeners, is hopefully towards the end of this month, of course, it'll be Halloween. And we like Halloween, don't we, Paul?
We do.
So we're going to try and get a couple of ghost stories together from Jason. And hopefully I'm going to have Mark Newbold on as well. So he's got a ghostly tale to tell as well. And hopefully... the mysterious tale of an American wealth in London. Radio Free Endor style.
Yeah.
will be a massive movie. You've got to check it out. I've just got to write it in time. Yeah. So we've got all that coming up. So it's great. So remember, you can show your love for this podcast with an official Radio Free Endor t-shirt, which are available on TeePublic. Also, iTunes is the best place to download us. And while you're there, please leave us a 5-star review, because we love 5-star reviews. And if you give us a 5-star review, we will read it out. In fact, the next person who gives us a 5-star review will get a special Star Wars Celebrations artwork by our good friend Jason W. Chrisman. I've got one here. I'll bring it out and I will post the details to you, but you've got to leave a 5-star rating. Yeah, please on iTunes, that'd be great. So you can also reach us on Instagram, Twitter. You get in contact. We're all over Twitter and Facebook, right? So you can email at Radio Free Endor. On Twitter, you can find us at Radio Free Endor. You can find me at Jamie_R_Burns. And you can get Paul
at Cutterroom 22.
Our email address is radiofreeendor@gmail.com. Mm-hmm. So it's goodbye from me, and it'll be...
It's goodbye from me.
We'll see you soon, and happy Halloween.
Bye-bye.
We must be cautious.